This episode of Just Seen It, we review Snitch, starring The Rock, Dwayne Johnson.
There is no way I'm gonna let either side dictate our fates.
It's based off of an actual story that was covered in a PBS Frontline documentary several years ago, detailing the injustices of mandatory minimums.
Based on the best-selling novel, Bless Me, Ultima.
Why is there evil in the world?
Amigo, you have so many questions.
And it's basically a coming-of-age tale where Antonio, through his mentor now, Ultima, kind of grows up and learns the ways of the world.
We chat with Sharon Seymour, production designer for Argo.
You're telling me that there is a movie company in Hollywood right now that is funded by the CIA?
Yes, sir.
We wanted it to feel very grounded in a reality of 1979, 1980.
And discuss the new thriller, Stoker.
It was 8:30 when you came home. The Trovatore was playing on PBS.
He has this mystery, and the film really lives and dies by how interesting this mystery is.
All right here on Just Seen It. John's son is wrongly jailed as a drug dealer.
I should have never taken that package. I'm not a drug dealer. I swear to you, Dad. You believe me, right?
Of course I believe you.
With Jason facing a 10-year sentence, John agrees to go undercover.
How are you supposed to help them?
By doing a drug deal.
Are you out of your mind?
By infiltrating a drug ring, John risks everything to free his son. In Snitch.
Hi, I'm Aaron. I'm Salim.
I'm Leah, and we have gathered here today to talk about the new film, Snitch, starring Dwayne The Rock Johnson. We've all just seen it.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think?
It was pretty awesome, actually. I was blown away by the awesomeness, in fact. It's based off of an actual story that was covered in a PBS Frontline documentary several years ago, detailing the injustices of mandatory minimums. There actually was an 18-year-old kid who got sentenced to 10 years in prison for conspiracy to distribute drugs, but he didn't.
Yeah.
And they tried to have his father set somebody up.
We think we know what the movie's going to be, action and muscles. But no, it's really not about that. It's about The Rock as John, who really wants to take care of his son who got put into prison wrongly.
The Rock's going to get in there, he's going to blow up some stuff, and he's going to punch some people and break some glass, and, you know, all of that happened to a certain degree, but it was way turned way down low, and it really does function as an indictment of the really bad policies, war on drug policies, and they really encouraged people to basically set other people up in order to drive up conviction rates and so that people could be elected, and we see all of that happening here in this movie, but it does not weigh the film down.
The beginning of it is a little bit procedural. We really follow John or The Rock throughout his days as he's trying to figure out what he can do. But it really kicks into high gear when John has to start working for the police in order to get his son a lower sentence.
The writing is so substantial that you believe it, you go with it, you just say, okay, I'm this parent, I would do the same thing too.
You're surprised by the weight of the acting, and it's a very straightforward story, and like you said, it's not too heavy-handed in its approach in talking about these politics and in dealing with an event that we would never think about happening, something that just is so terrible.
It's great that you mentioned the acting because, you know, do we really expect that much from Dwayne Johnson?
No.
Boy,
I like the rundown.
I even like the Tooth Fairy.
He's not the muscles and the brawn. Even though there are scenes where you think you know what's going to happen because, you know, he's with some toughs or some big guys that are, you know, not as big as him, and you're just waiting for him to beat him up.
The biggest bodyguard in the drug gang is not as big as The Rock.
But that's what's great about it, is that he's vulnerable. It's really about this father who's just trying to figure it out and not trying to beat everybody up in order to make that. Because when he does try that, it doesn't work.
He gets beat up.
He gets beat up, which is by street punks, right? Yeah. It's just like, whoa, this is a bit of a departure for him.
I know you've done this before, undercover. Do you have any advice?
Just be yourself, John. Try to be something you're not. They're bloodhounds, they'll smell it right away. You're a family man, you're trying to stay afloat. You got means they can use. That's it. You hide in plain sight, you just keep doing what you're doing. And they'll believe it, because it's the truth.
This is a really interesting cast. You know, a story like this could have had a really... It could have been really cheesy, really jacked up, but they did some really interesting casting, starting with The Rock. But the supporting cast was actually pretty awesome also.
And substantial.
Extremely, and substantial. Yeah. This mix of A-list talent with these great faces that we recognize from TV. We have Melina Kanakarides from Providence.
John Bernthal from The Walking Dead.
Yeah. Walking Dead. Shane, you know? We had Harold Perrineau from Oz and from Lost.
We also have Michael Kenneth Williams, famous from The Wire. Susan Sarandon is a U.S. attorney who I hate as a character because she's so good as an actress. Mm-hmm. She's a Republican U.S. attorney who doesn't want to help Dwayne Johnson's character at all. Just, you know, that's the way mandatory minimums are, she says.
Well, you know, a film is only as good as its direction, and we've got this film that's, oh my gosh, maybe it's only his second feature film. Mm-hmm. This guy used to be a stuntman.
Yeah, Rick Roman Waugh. The film before this was Felon, which not that big of a movie.
It had Val Kilmer in it.
With this a neck true. Tattoo.
and again, you think you know this movie. It's a movie directed by a former stuntman. Right. Starring The Rock.
Right.
But this is not an action movie.
They're going to come after our families, John.
Daniel, I know I'm the one who put us all in this danger. And I got to live with that. But there is no way I'm going to let either side dictate our fates.
The cinematographer, Dana Gonzalez, he gets in there with the little handheld shaky cam stuff to create these quiet, intimate moments. Like, he really maximizes those moments, whether it's, you know, a jail room conversation on the phone to the shootout where we feel like we're in, you know, a war zone. It's like war correspondent footage. Mm-hmm. And then he can scale it up and give us these big action sequences.
Well, there's just so much about the film that works. We have the acting, the directing, the writing. He also co-wrote the film, and you realize that this is a story that he needed and wanted to tell.
Yeah. I really hope people don't sleep on this film. Not trying to hype it. It is solid, right? It is a solid kind of workhorse of a movie. But the politics are there. It's clear the filmmakers have a point of view and they feel like they had something to say. And I really hope that the marketing doesn't mislead people and people get disappointed, because it does look like an action film.
Yeah. Snitch surpassed my expectations. It was a well-made film and it will really please its fans. So I say see it.
Indeed, Snitch is a surprise of a film with some wonderful acting and poignant story. See it.
This film could have been a cheese-filled disaster, but all the elements came together and gave us a really solid thriller that makes Snitch worth snitching about. See it.
Cheers.
Cheers to Snitch.
Cheers to I have smelled what The Rock is cooking.
And it is good.
Ultima is a curandera, a healer and protector in Native American culture. When she comes to live with Antonio, she teaches him about her spiritual world. Under her guidance, he grows in his faith in Bless Me, Ultima.
Hi, I'm Rachel.
I'm Sean.
And I'm Brenna. And we're here to talk about Bless Me, Ultima, the new film adaptation of Rodolfo Anaya's award-winning novel. We've all just seen it.
Bless Me, Ultima follows a young boy named Antonio, and his family is visited by Ultima, who is a curandera, or a Native American healer. And it's basically a coming-of-age tale where Antonio, through his mentor now, Ultima, kind of grows up and learns the ways of the world, if you will.
This story has a lot of Chicano culture in it. It has a lot of magical realism, the way that it's written, and it's a very refreshing feel to it. The problem is there's just not enough plot. The story that it's based on is very, it's widely read, it's well put together. For some reason in this film, they haven't borrowed quite enough from the book.
I think that they were trying to keep it as a very simple story of this 7-year-old and his experiences as he tries to come to terms with philosophy and religion and good, bad, evil nature, the whole reason why bad things happen.
Mm-hmm.
And in doing so, they left out a lot of the other stuff because they're trying to concentrate on him and his journey.
Well, even so, the conflicts aren't drawn out as clearly as they could be. So the movie ends in a way that isn't that satisfying.
Well, I haven't read the book, so I don't know how to compare the two. I actually didn't see it so much as a conflict. I mean, the sort of Catholicism angle of it, I was quite fascinated with. This is one of the only times I can really think about a movie exploring faith through the eyes of a child. And I thought that was very genuine, especially the questions that he asks.
Papa, why is there evil in the world?
Amigo, you have so many questions. Didn't the priest talk about it in church?
But I'd like to know your answer.
The curandera is known for using a lot of Catholic elements, holy water and prayers and things like that. So I almost saw it as two sides of the same coin.
I think the only thing that we really go into in detail is good versus evil, a very literal good versus evil representation. Yeah. The villain character, played by Castulo Guerra, is like one cackle away from tying somebody to the train tracks.
I know about the curse, and I know when and where it was laid. And you're a fool if you don't tell them to lift it.
Bruja, you shame my daughters and my good name in front of these men. I will see you dead.
It just, it's a very emotional story, and it never seems to reach the emotional heights that that's intended. Perhaps that's in the source material, but as a movie, we have a character of the child who goes through a lot over the course of this picture. I mean, he faces down death.
Have you not heard?
Heard what, hombre? Oh,
Dios mío, living in this cross hill away from town. Today, Tenorio's daughter, his witch died. He blames La Grande for it.
And yet, we're sort of just left with a kid who just sort of goes, okay, and moves on to the next scene. And I don't know whether that's the performance or the directing or both. This kid, Luke Ganelon, who plays Antonio, he's got a good presence and he's natural in what he intends to do, but there's no emotion there.
It's very odd. It's odd because it's this beautiful story. You have this young boy who's being taken care of by this older woman who is just a gorgeous character and a gorgeous actor, but you're right, there isn't that punch, which there should be. For the first half, I was just so in love with, like, the story, the culture, everything that I was seeing. But then at about the midway point, it starts to drag, and it just drags more and more.
The story is extremely flat. The emotions, the conflict, everything is just very...
It's very superficial.
Yeah, it's extremely superficial, because they tell you everything, either in conversation or in voiceover.
And again, the director, Carl Franklin, I don't know if that's because he has a kid and he's worried that the kid can't give us the emotion because he's not a good enough actor, but we have pretty much everything told to us, all the emotions of this character told to us through this voiceover by Alfred Molina. And Alfred Molina's fantastic. He's got a great voice. The narration is perfectly read. But at the same time, I'm going, well, can't we get something out of the character that we can be shown rather than it
half
being told
to us? Half the
things
that he says in voiceover can be shown to us, and which would help make up for the fact that the film is so slow.
Miriam Colon, who plays Ultima in this movie, is fantastic. Like you said, she's a curandera. She's a sort of a witch doctor. And she just, the acting is gorgeous. She has such presence. She feels like Mother Earth. On camera.
What's that?
It's the spirit of the river.
Can it speak?
Yes. Listen.
I think my favorite part of this film is the cinematography by Paolo Huidobro. It is absolutely beautiful.
It is.
These wide, sweeping shots of the llanos and the hills.
That is definitely the high point of this film. You want to go out in nature. I mean, I'm just watching, I'm going, I want to go hiking. The way that they show these things, the way they show the grass, the sky, you really feel like you're right there.
Yeah, they really get out there. I mean, it's almost like an old Western, like a John Ford movie or something. They're on location, you could feel it. It's not Monument Valley, but it's definitely New Mexico.
Bless Me, Ultima is a beautiful film with really wonderful Chicano flavor. It's just, there's not enough story to go around, so I give it a stream it.
It's a decent film for anyone looking for an adaptation of the novel, but it won't appeal to anyone beyond the intended audience. So I say stream it.
Bless Me, Ultima is a beautiful yet extremely slow film that will probably be shown in literature classes around the country. If you like this kind of stuff, stream it.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Bless you.
Bless you.
Bless
you. Bless me. Our DVD pick of the week is Paul Thomas Anderson's The Master. When we reviewed it this past summer, we gave it a see it, and both Joaquin Phoenix and Amy Adams were nominated for Oscars for their performances.
How did I get down here?
You're acting aggressive because you drank too much alcohol.
What do you do
I am a writer, a doctor, a nuclear physicist, a theoretical philosopher. But above all, I am a man, just like you.
Also out this week is the surfing drama Chasing Mavericks, directed by Michael Apted and Curtis Hanson, and starring Gerard Butler and Johnny Weston. We gave that a stream it.
A few things we need to establish before we begin. First, thou shalt not dang Frosty's board or damage thy neighbor's car.
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir.
And finally, there's a Twilight Saga Breaking Dawn Part 2.
So beautiful. We're the same temperature now.
So there you have it. Three very different movies for you to catch at home.
Hi, I'm David.
I'm Sean.
Hi, I'm Sharon.
We're pleased to have with us today Sharon Seymour, a production designer on such films as Argo, The Town, The Ides of March, and the upcoming reimagination of Old Boy. Thank you for being here, Sharon.
It's a pleasure to have you. And for our viewing audience, why don't you go into just a quick explanation of what a production designer does?
Essentially, you're responsible for the physical environment of a film. The locations, the sets, the set dressing, the props.
So for Argo, which is a recent film that you worked on, it's very successful, has been nominated for several Academy Awards. Argo is a film that takes place at a very specific time. You know, it's based on a true story, so it takes place during the Iranian hostage crisis of 1979. Does that make it any easier to design? Does it make it more difficult? Is it about the same no matter what?
Well, I think we all felt that we had a responsibility to the fact that it was based on a true story, and we wanted it to feel very grounded in a reality of 1979, 1980, without feeling that it was a cartoon of that time.
Was there any major differences between how you originally envisioned the film to look and then how it actually turned out on screen?
Nothing's ever exactly the way you plan it.
Sure.
But we did have a really strong sense of how we wanted the film to look in its three segments. You have the government segment, Washington, CIA, State Department. You have the Hollywood segment.
Which I love.
Warner Brothers, the publicity event. And then you have the Tehran experience as they try to get out of the country. And we were shooting different parts of those three things all over the place to get that to have a consistent look. At the end, I was visually very satisfied and thought it really hit the mark and just blown away by the storytelling of it.
You're gonna do a $20 million Star Wars ripoff. You need somebody who's a somebody to put their name on it. Somebody respectable.
So, like directors and writers who have a specific voice and a vision, production designers have a voice as well. What would you say your voice is?
I try very hard not to make the movie about the design.
Right.
As a filmmaker, I want an audience to just be going along with the story, not being taken out of the story because, oh, look at that fabulous piece of 1970s set dressing.
Right.
Or anything that distracts from the bottom line, which is telling a good story.
Do you have a particular film or a piece of work that inspired you and made you say, wow, I really want to be a production designer?
I never really looked at production design in a movie and said, oh my goodness, this is what I want to do. I was working in New York doing a lot of theater, and I got an opportunity to work through theater context. I got an opportunity to work on George Romero's Creepshow.
Oh.
And I went and worked on that movie with a crew that was primarily made up of sort of crossover theater people. And I realized that this was this opportunity I'd never really thought of. And then that movie was made in Pittsburgh. When I went back to New York City, I started to do more television, sort of early public television stuff, American Playhouse and Theater in America. And I said, I want to do this. I want to pursue this. And it seemed like the mecca of that was Hollywood. And I moved to Los Angeles and went to American Film Institute in production design.
What was your first big break?
Probably the first thing that really switched my career here in California was doing the Ben Stiller Show, which I agonized over doing because it was a television show. Ben Stiller was not Ben Stiller.
No.
He was an unknown.
It was like 20 years ago, right?
It was,
yeah,
and
I
it was an HBO, almost 20 years ago, it was an HBO series, so there wasn't that much viewership, and I was doing film, and I thought, oh, I'm making this, this is going to be a terrible mistake, and it wasn't. It was a great opportunity, because then Ben Stiller and Judd Apatow, who was a producer on the Ben Stiller Show, took me along, and I did Reality Bites, and then I did Cable Guy, and that got me a really intelligent, wonderful agent, and really changed everything.
So you never know.
You never know, and then Ben Affleck has made a huge difference as well.
Well, as is tradition here at Just Seen It, we'd like to thank you very much for coming and give you a cheers. Raise your glass, and here we go. Thanks so much.
Thank you guys for having me.
To Argo, and it was a pleasure.
After her dad dies, India's Uncle Charlie comes to live with her and her mom.
India, come and say hello to your Uncle Charlie.
Unaware of his existence, India suspects Charlie has ulterior motives.
What do you want from me?
To be friends.
But she soon becomes infatuated with him in Stoker.
Hi, I'm Aaron.
I am Liz.
And I'm Salim, and we're here to talk about Stoker, directed by Park Chan-wook, written by actor Wentworth Miller. We've all just seen it. Aaron, why don't you tell us a little bit about it?
All right, well, this story is about India Stoker and her mother, Evie Stoker. India's father has just passed away, and on the day of the funeral, her uncle Charlie, who the family has never heard or seen from, appears.
And this is quite an odd film, mainly because of Uncle Charlie. He has this mystery, and the film really lives and dies by how interesting this mystery is and how intriguing it is as it unfolds.
The setup of the story is very slow, intriguing, and you don't really know where it's going. And that's actually my favorite part of the film. That's where you see the directing and the writing and the performances really shine. I'd say about halfway through the film twist into something you're not necessarily expecting, and it turns into a film that explores the definition of evil and the transference of evil.
Yeah, I think it's different in a good way. Yeah. It slowly reveals information in the beginning, and then it kind of picks up and reveals more and more as time goes by. And it really hooked me with the weird uncle plot. I had no idea what he was doing, why he was there, just that he's creepy and probably doing bad things.
Well, we don't know.
We don't know, but we know that there's an air of mystery to this guy. And yes, the very beginning is a little bit slow, but if you pay attention to this film, once you get to the end, it all makes sense.
It's fascinating by the end.
Oh, by the way, did your housekeeper ever get in touch after leaving town so quick?
No. She didn't.
Strange how people can just disappear on you.
Well, the story is highly influenced by Hitchcock's Shadow of a Doubt, except I think it has a little bit of a supernatural twist to it. I almost thought it was going to be a vampire film, to be honest. And then we have all these tropes of insects representing evil characters and insects revolving around characters who have evil tendencies.
Not everything makes sense, but the fact that it's not cut and dry, to me, makes it a better film than something that's just A, B, C, or something that has so many questions and no answers.
The film attempts to define what a woman is in relation to her sexuality, and I think it does it in a very thin way. We have a character who receives shoes every year as a birthday present, and our 18th birthday she receives high heels, and it's supposed to symbolize her newfound sexuality. And I just think it's an outdated symbol for a woman and her quote-unquote freedom.
Mia Wasikowska was our lead, India, and I thought she was quite wonderful. She makes a lot of scowling faces in this one, but she's very compelling, she's very believable, she is weird, and her performance mirrors that, and I think that our director Park Chan-wook probably wanted this kind of a performance, and it works very well.
Mia Wasikowska has actually been one of my favorite actresses to come out as of late. She's been very strong in the majority of her films, and I really liked her character because at first you think she's vulnerable and just quiet, but then you realize as the story progresses that it's actually calculation, that she has a lot of these conflicting ideas and emotions, and she's really just trying to figure it out. Well, let's talk about Matthew Good. He plays Uncle Charlie.
Awesome. Definitely the best part of the film, in my opinion. He's unsettling, he's terrifying, he's creepy. I really don't know what he's gonna do or why he's gonna do it, and he was extremely committed to his role.
I must have been blushing. It was my first time outside with a boy, and I didn't want to be seen by anyone.
It was 8:30 when you came home. The Trovatore was playing on PBS.
He actually petitioned and campaigned to get this role.
Well, it's an incredibly difficult role to have. I mean, you don't know much about Matthew Good's character, and he doesn't get to explain a lot about who he is, yet he always has a glint in his eye in every scene. Mm-hmm. I think for a very difficult role, he did stupendously.
And then Nicole Kidman was India's mother, Evie, who I personally wasn't very impressed with. I think it might have had to do with the way her character was written. She's just very one-dimensional in terms of her character motivations.
Personally speaking, I can't wait to watch life tear you apart.
No, I agree. She's cold, but it's... I felt like her character was not necessary. You could have taken the character out, and there would have been a lot of the same kind of storyline and themes.
I disagree, you guys. I thought she was wonderful. I thought as a mother, she had a lot of resentment for her child. That was so interesting to mm-hmm. see a character who was blatantly resentful.
Park Chan-wook directed this, who is most famous for directing the Korean movie Old Boy, and there's a lot of the same kind of visual flares in this one.
Yeah, this is basically the American Old Boy. Mm-hmm. I mean, it explores the same incest themes that were rampant throughout Old Boy. Mm-hmm. Specifically, the visual style is just as dynamic as it was in Old Boy. I think a lot of people look to foreign directors, and when they work with American or British actors, they look at and they worry that maybe they're going to lose some of their charm that they mm-hmm. had in an international level. He's
Not
still strong here.
Yeah, his style is very unique. I think this was the best part of the film as a whole, is the production, the cinematography, the sound design. I loved the sound design, you know,
me being
a sound person and all.
Stoker is a very unique film. However, I definitely see an audience for it, and it's well made. See it.
Stoker was definitely a weird and unsettling movie, but I was captivated by it. I definitely think it's for the art house crowd, but it's a see it.
Stoker is indeed a strange movie, but is assisted heavily with some phenomenal acting. See it.
Cheers,
guys!
Huzzah!
Here at Just Seen It, we really are industry professionals trying to make it in the business. One of our reviewers, Brenna Smith, was in the new comedy 21 and Over. I had the pleasure of seeing this comedy at the world premiere and wanted to give it a quick review.
21 years ago, Jeff Chang entered the world naked and screaming. Tonight,
I'll be 21 forever!
He'll end up the same way.
Oh my God.
21 and Over follows in the footsteps of comedies like The Hangover and 21 Jump Street. In fact, John Lucas and Scott Moore, who wrote the script for The Hangover, also wrote the script for this film. This is a fresh, fun, and timely movie about three friends who have a wild night celebrating a 21st birthday.
Jeff Chang, this is your 21st birthday.
This is a movie that was meant to be seen in theaters, and that's why I'm giving it a see it. Finally, everyone here at Just Seen It would like to congratulate Brenna on her role as the head sorority sister. If I said anything more about her performance, I'd be giving things away. So head out to the theaters and check out this great movie.
On our next episode, we review Oz, The Great and Powerful, starring James Franco as the famous wizard. We check out Tina Fey's new comedy, Admission, and see if it makes the grade. And we set our sights on this out-of-the-world drama, Upside Down. Thanks for watching, and see you next week.
Stokerine, and Stoker's everywhere.
Stoker, I hardly know her.